So welcome to the Digital Economist from the World Economic Forum here in Davos, Switzerland. We are holding our inaugural roundtable and very excited to have a huge turnover and a highly curated roundtable. Is an impact platform focused on thought leadership and bringing investable opportunities in alignment with the sustainable development goals to the fore. So we're very excited to welcome folks on January 23rd this evening and looking forward to a great partnership and a lot of value we create for the community along the way. So welcome.
And welcome everyone. My name is Navroop Sahdev and I am the founder and CEO of the Digital Economist, which is a global impact ecosystem focused on building the knowledge pieces, the products, services, and the programs towards human and planetary outcomes. And we're super delighted as we kind of draw close towards the end of season two to have with us Harsh Acharya, whom actually I met on Clubhouse. So that's another interesting story there. To join us today from Dell, who is the VP of Global E-Commerce Experience. Harsh, I hope I said your new title and more exciting title correctly. So thank you very much and welcome and thanks for joining us today.
Well, glad to be here. Glad to be here. And thank you for inviting me. And it's always great to have conversations around where the future of work is going and where the digital footprint is going across the globe.
Thank you. Wow. So exciting. You know, talking about future work, of course, I can't help but mention that just 2 seconds before we started this webinar, we actually just concluded the last panel discussion for the Future Work Summit. And of course, it's only 10 a.m. for me in Hawaii, but the East Coast is, almost towards the end of this of the day, end of the work week, in fact. And I know we talked about this, and it's a very exciting topic for those, obviously, in bigger companies who are in leadership roles. I mean, that is a thing that is a critical piece of all of work that they, you know, first and foremost had to tackle with the COVID crisis. And I think more timely than ever. So I know your focus is on e-commerce, which is a pretty big practice, right, within Dell Technologies, as you shared. But you know, how about we start with some of your insights on that? And I would love to then just dive a little bit deeper into you, your story. We look similar. Why is that the case? So maybe we can kind of go into that and talk about other things.
No, that sounds great. And why don't we just start with a quick introduction that would just help set the context. Sure. On what I do here at Dell, and then we can talk about how things change post COVID when it comes to how we work. So, like you said, Navroop, my name is Harsh Acharya, and I'm responsible for e-commerce technology and product at Dell. It is a very critical aspect of our business, where especially post COVID, we saw a large percentage of our customers wanting to shop online even more than we did before. So it's even more important than it was just a year ago. I'm responsible for driving Dell.com and our business-to-business premier experience for our customers across 130 countries. We do business in about 80 languages, and my organization helps bring new experiences to life on Dell.com, and we are spread across 13 different countries and different cultures. And so when we had to go from working in the offices across so many different countries to having to work from home, It was quite a change. And there are a few things that worked really well and a few things that we really had to adapt to. The things that worked really well was being a tech company, we were truly prepared for working from home. Our VPN capacity was great. We had all the right tools, Microsoft Teams, Zoom, collaboration tools, chat tools. So we never felt like we were handicapped. You know, it just was that great. And every person on the team had laptops. Even if they had desktops, they were able to connect to them via VDI and other measures. So that, you know, worked really well. The initial shock was really when we realized that we would have to do this for much longer than just a few weeks. You know, initially, when we all started working from home, it was like, you know, this would be for a couple of weeks and the cases will go down
cool.
and we'll be back.
It's actually nothing. Nice, right? Yeah. In the beginning.
Yeah, like it's a break, right? And when it kicked in that, that, you know, we really have to do it for a much longer period of time, while technology and collaboration tools was not an issue, it's that human interaction, whiteboarding, how do we do stand-up meetings like we were used to do before, and that human-to-human interaction is where we really had to adapt. So that's the first part where we had to find new set of tools where we can do virtual prioritization exercises, virtual whiteboarding with each other, figure out a way to do, you know, stand-up meetings that is as interactive as it used to be before. And that part took some time, you know, where teams were like, well, this is just not going to work to now. Well, this can actually work. And then second thing that we really had to pay a lot of attention to was initially, at least, you know, when people now had to have, you know, kids at home, you know, schooling from home. They were, you know, a lot of people were taking care of their elderly, you know, folks at home. It was important for us to make sure that the teams feel empowered to work flexible hours. And we went out of our way to make sure that they are taking the time to take care of their families. If it means that, you know, they work for a few hours, take some time off, and then, you know, pick it back up in the evening or whatever works for them. So we gave them that flexibility. And then third thing that we did, from a mental health standpoint and from a standpoint of making sure that people don't, you know, fall into the entire, you know, online meeting fatigue, was really bringing down our 30-minute meetings to 20-minute meetings, bringing down our one-hour-long meetings to 45-minute meetings, and really ensuring that teams are able to take that break between constant, you know, interactions over the internet. So we have come a long way. Do I still miss, you know, being in the office? I do. I'm kind of a person who loves stopping by, you know, people's desks, grabbing coffee with them. And I still hope that, you know, in a few months here or at least in the next 9 to 12 months, we can get back to being able to do that at least for a few days a week or a month, if not every day.
Yeah, so many things you've said. And, you know, we had a whole bunch of panels, Harsh, like I said, over the past two days. And I saw a very humanistic point of view that continued to surface. And I think what you just said very much is in the same spirit. Although, of course, you've mentioned, you know, the very critical implications for innovation, because it requires those human interactions. Right. And I was saying the same thing to my team the other day. I was like, we should be in a room and be whiteboarding this together. And it's just so hard and things get stretched out. Right. And that has implications for productivity. So I'm curious to hear, Harsh, from what you just said, and I have more to add here. At MIT, we've kind of developed a bunch of tools using AI, you know, and there's one startup called Riff Learning, and I know they raised a round recently, again, spin-off from MIT Connection Science. How do you take the learning from cognitive sciences, apply that to innovation by leveraging tech, right? And that, again, becomes important when you're looking at large-scale kind of digital flattening of the world, if you may. But I'm curious to hear, you know, from your experience, it sounds like, of course, Dell was very well equipped, you know, as a multi-billion dollar company, you know, but like, how do you then have been dealing with some of the issues around how do you innovate and continue to stay innovative, right? Something that you mentioned is a challenge, but in terms of the solutioning, what are some of the ways you found And just, you know, from, I guess, from a larger corporate experience, I'm just kind of curious to hear, because like smaller teams can kind of deal with it, but like, how do you do like all hands on meetings, right? When it's like a few thousand people. So yeah, over to you.
You know, the good thing was that even pre-pandemic, since we were so geographically, you know, located across so many different countries, we had to learn how to innovate, you know, working across across the oceans. That said, we used to have co-located teams that, you know, working on a single product can innovate much faster. So a couple of things that we had to tweak. We have been very human-centric, design-driven in our innovation, in our product strategy, and how we build things. And in the past, the way we used to interact with our actual customers was actually bringing them into the labs, into the offices, or going to them, right? We would go and meet gamers to understand how gamers shop on Dell.com. We had to figure out how to take that virtually as well and start doing that virtually. And we did have access to some tools that would allow us to recruit our user base and customers over the internet. We just had to amp it up even more than we used to do before. Now, can that replace, you know, everything we used to do from a usability standpoint in person? No, but because we had worked across multiple countries for a long time, we were able to adapt. But the other thing I would say is that it also kind of helped us level the playing field, because in the past, when our teams, let's say in Ireland, were trying to build capabilities that are supposed to be used across the globe, you know, when you have some teams on the phone and some other teams in the room, it actually makes it very difficult for the teams on the phone to get a word in, right? There is always this unconscious, you know, the teams in the room taking over. And so the flip side that I saw was that while it becomes a little more difficult to innovate, you are not whiteboarding as much as you did before, you are actually able to get a lot more different inputs from different cultures and different countries in, and it really leveled the playing field. So we saw that as a trade-off. You know, we are now hearing a lot more from our teams in APJ and Europe awesome. Than we did before, because everyone is on the same Zoom call. But there is definitely some deficit with not being able to, you know, do whiteboarding, et cetera, that we are just balancing it out.
So would you say that would actually bring more awareness of diversity, of diverse thoughts and thinking? And again, from a human-centric design perspective, critical pieces that go into building products that people want and would, you know, resonate with, you know, over a longer period of time because of the pandemic. I mean, it sounds like it was great for you guys.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. You know, the diversity of thoughts, you know, really skyrocketed with this, because you know, we are now able to have everyone on a level playing field. The other thing, you know, it helps with is that when you are on video, we actually did not use video as much when we used to have meetings in person. The other people used to be on the phone, only on audio. Right. And what we are now doing is that when we are meeting together now, it's a lot more video than it used to be before. So there's definitely a big silver lining that we at least saw, you know, from our standpoint. But as you said earlier, right, it does vary from company to company. The companies that are just, you know, building up, they are in one region and they are trying to innovate very fast. They have to create their first product. I can imagine this being much more difficult for them than it turned out to be for us.
Mm. And what would you say are sort of the implications within sort of the larger firm? How do you sort of see that playing out? And then let's switch gears to fintech, which I'm very excited to hear from you about. But yeah, just one like quick sort of like, so 2 years down the line, do you think this is going to be a net positive or a net negative? The world's probably going to go back to in-person, and it sounds like it probably would bring back those kind of the unequal playing field that was there. And you know, this happens all the time, like particularly the North America teams tend to be a lot more you know, aggressively doing things, if I were to use some corporate jargon here. And so how do you kind of see that playing out over the next months and years?
I think my prediction is that work from home is here to stay, even in the long run. There would be a hybrid model when people really need to collaborate in person. They would get together probably a couple of times a week, a couple of times a month. The biggest benefit, I think, at least in tech, large companies are going to see, and they're already seeing, is that being able to work remotely has opened up not just, you know, the aspect of leveling the playing field across the globe. It has also opened up larger talent pool than they had before. Especially if you think about the companies in the Bay Area, you know, they were struggling to make people to move to, you know, the Bay Area. And now, you know, if everyone is remote, you know, they can actually recruit people anywhere. Because if you have ever been remote and the rest of your teams, you know, were working in person, you would know that it's tough to, you know, stay connected. And it's actually easier when everyone is, you know, working remotely. So even for us, you know, it has helped us remove the boundaries of certain cities or certain offices that we used to be in. For example, in India, we had offices in a few cities, but we are now recruiting across many more cities than we did before. Same in the US. We are now able to recruit from places outside of Austin, Texas, where we are, you know, headquartered. So really, I think there is a huge benefit that large companies are going to see with being able to, you know, continue the way we are operating now, with some flexibility from a hybrid standpoint to be able to go into the office when the teams really need to.
Yeah, and I think we also see that from an investment perspective as to where the money is moving. The other day, we had the craziest clubhouse room, I have to tell you, Harsh, and we just laughed our asses off. And the point was that all the VCs who were first importing the guys from India to the US are now going to India. And, you know, we were importing like the big, perhaps some of the most famous, not only venture capital names, but also investment bank, SoftBank, and others who are very seriously looking at starting to invest in that geography. And, you know, we could double click on that perhaps towards the end of this call, of course, with that sort of shared history, if you may. And I know we got some awesome folks here from the community joining, Pradeep, Ansari, Anthony, and Sydney. But yeah, let's double click a little bit on your role, Harsh, in your capacity. So you're leading all of product development as it pertains to e-commerce in Dell, which is a huge practice, right? I think you mentioned $25 billion worldwide. So what are some of the key things that you're looking at, and what does it mean for the future within the post-pandemic world? How is e-commerce being transformed, right? And that's a very broad question. So I will have follow-ups, but over to you. I want to kind of hear a little bit about your story and kind of how you got in this role as well, in fact.
Yeah. You know, I started at Dell 13 years ago as a software engineer, straight out of school. And I actually got introduced to e-commerce when I was helping out with some of the back-end product data systems across the globe. And it really intrigued me because of it being so customer-facing. And you know, 13 years ago, e-commerce was already prominent, at least in North America, but it was still new in a lot of, you know, developing countries. And I started as a product manager for different kinds of e-commerce experiences, from shopping to checkout to loyalty and personalization, really expanding my wings, learning different aspects of it within Dell's consumer and business e-commerce area. And then I slowly, you know, moved into managing the product management teams, managing the engineering teams, and running it for both B2B and B2C. And what I saw and what we saw in the past 12 months was really the acceleration of e-commerce adoption that was already taking place. You know, 5 years ago, when it came to e-commerce, there were certain categories that people would shop online for. There were other categories that were lagging, right? even 5-6 years ago across the globe, you wouldn't see people buying groceries online or even clothes online. We used to see in some of our categories where people would still like to go to retail stores and would like to go and, you know, touch and feel laptops and desktops before they make buying decisions. And what we saw in the last 12 months is really the acceleration of wanting to buy everything online, right? Part of it was because, you know, of closure of brick and mortar stores or them being, you know, limited in access. But the other part was people realizing that you can do a lot of these things online. Just because the average order value of the product you're buying is high, doesn't mean that you have to go and, you know, buy it from a physical location. And so, yeah, you know, it was a great year for us to not only cater to our customers who were now, you know, buying a lot of things online, but also to make sure that we can keep our systems up and running for the huge demand lift that we saw in the past 12 months. So it was definitely great for teams to kind of, you know, take advantage of the shift.
Mm-hmm. So you're basically saying that the e-commerce practice, if you may, has exponentially expanded because of the pandemic, and obviously because people were forced to stay home, right? So if you had to shop something, then you don't have a choice but to do that. But then I think the evolving needs as well, because now you have to set up office at home, right? Suddenly you have to purchase all these things that earlier you would just, you know, pick up your purse and go to the office and things would be set up there. And so, you know, curious to hear, and a great place to be. Congratulations, by the way, Harsh, I gotta say, and, you know, with, you know, such a fast growing, you know, part of the firm that you're spearheading. So where do you see then the future of, you know, payments and financial technology that more broadly, that is perhaps the biggest component of e-commerce, right? To make that experience seamless. Obviously, I think the innovation is first and foremost in the payment space, right? Where the commercial aspect is. And then of course, you know, user experience and human-centric design, or at least historically that has been the case, right? And so, you know, I'm sure you've seen a lot of action and perhaps are keeping a very close pulse on the crypto space. So, you know, take it away. Where do you want to take this, you know, on fintech?
Yeah, wow. You know, it's a very interesting topic and very close to my heart. You know, I will kind of separate out, you know, just the basics of what we see with the payment ecosystem between developed countries and developing countries. And then we can kind of go into, you know, where we are going with crypto. That's always a fun topic to talk about. But the dynamics that we are seeing in the market is that the developed countries like the United States and Europe, where we had a robust, you know, payment engines, payment options, you know, scaling all the way from credit cards to PayPal's of the world and Google Pay's and Apple Pay's of the world. It is shifting from I want to use an online payment option to pay to I want to use this payment option to make it convenient for me to you know, make a purchase and make it really fast. So, you know, I'll give a simple example. You know, 10 years ago, it was a big thing that you can go to an online website, put in your credit card number, you can complete a purchase. Like, wow, you know, I'm able to do that. That has now become like, that is just basic expectation. Now, the expectation is that when I go to a website, based on my login with Apple or Google or PayPal or, you know, Visa, I should simply be able to log in. And it should know what my billing address is, what my shipping address is. So payment in the developed countries has expanded from being payment to wallets to completely end-to-end checkout experiences that you can just, you know, execute on within one click and you are done with your checkout. And that is really helping balance the checkout experience between the likes of, you know, Amazon and eBay, so marketplaces where people are always logged in, so checkout is really fast. Non-marketplaces where the buying cycle is longer are now able to take advantage of the likes of Google Pay and Apple Pay and saying that, look, you know, you may not be logging into this website every day, but even if you log in now, you don't have to go through seven different steps to complete your payment. You can log into one of the wallets and even complete checkout. So those are the dynamics. And what it means for the players like us and, you know, many e-commerce players is that you have to keep up with changing landscapes and the expectations of customers on the level of convenience that they need. And so if let's say Google Pay is starting to take a lot more, you know, traction, you have to make sure you can quickly react to it and adapt to it and, you know, give it to your customers. But the other thing we are seeing in the developed countries is that the consortiums like Visa, MasterCard, et cetera, they also want to take advantage of, you know, them being the end, you know, transaction providers. And they are also coming up with their own options in the market to allow customers to have the same level of convenience. And I think, you know, at some point, it's definitely not a zero-sum game, but at some point we are going to see some consolidation, if not to a single wallet, to a couple of different wallets that are really going to be dominant in the market in the developed countries. And we, you know, track it very carefully. What's happening in developing countries like, you know, India and Brazil and China, where they did not have robust, you know, payment ecosystem, and they are rapidly coming up with new payment options, including the ones that governments are sponsoring to make it easier. And there, the, you know, e-commerce companies are really struggling because the new payment options are coming up faster than they can adopt them. And they are also being adopted by the customer base faster than, you know, you think. And so today, if you are, you know, offering XYZ options in India, within 3 months, you know, 30% of traffic would expect a different payment option that you don't have. And so really the challenge that e-commerce companies are tackling in the developing countries is really being able to keep up with major shifts, larger shifts in payment options. So it's really interesting dynamics. And the last thing I'll touch on, crypto. I think Elon Musk just announced that, you know, you can now buy Tesla using Bitcoin. I actually was a product manager who enabled Bitcoin on Dell.com 7 years ago as the largest e-commerce company back then to accept Bitcoin. And we actually, you know, ran it, you know, for about a year, 2 years. We have turned it off for now because we saw a lot of momentum. We saw, you know, people wanting to use it. Back then, you know, Bitcoin was $400 and not $60,000 like today. But we also saw that, you know, that it was very specific demographics, at least back then, that were using crypto as a payment option. Something we should, you know, we should revisit in the future. But I think I'm kind of torn on whether crypto would become a real payment option across e-commerce ecosystem in the long run, not discounting the value of crypto as you know, in its pure economic sense or pure, you know, the comparison that they drive with gold standard that used to be there in the past sense. I think it's a fantastic technology. I think blockchain makes so many things so simple to track and to maintain smart contracts, etc. But I think jury is still out on whether it can be used as a normal payment type on a day-to-day basis on online or offline.
Yeah, that's so interesting because that was going to be my question as you were talking about. We actually seen concentration of things sort of reducing down to a couple of wallets. And I was like, well, what about the decentralized space? But I think you've already sort of responded to that. So that's super interesting. And by the way, I just wanted to comment that Elon Musk says a lot of things and it's unclear which of these are joke or if any of these could be taken seriously. So, but we do know what a lot of those comments do in terms of moving markets. And that's entirely other topic about responsible leadership and, you know, how kind of the pumping and the SEC almost about removed him as a, you know, the CEO of Tesla a few years ago when Tesla went public, right? And so anyway, we can definitely gossip there. But we do have a question from Anthony here, who, by the way, and as we sort of transition from kind of talking from B2B to B2C, from B2C to B2B, I think this is also kind of a great segue in that, which I know is a space Anthony is a lot more active in. But yeah, he asked, Dell was better prepared than most companies to adjust workforce to work from home. And how well the supply chains, which again, I know you're very passionate about, Harsh, you know, the third party vendors, which was the kind of the key thing around just, you know, acquiring and, you know, a lot of these services and products, and how do they keep pace with SLAs and if any challenges that are present there? I think that's a spot on, hard hitting question from Anthony. So thank you for that, Harsh. Over to you. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, so there are two aspects of supply chain, right? One is being able to manage the warehouses and being able to manage the supply chain with, you know, safely. And, you know, it was very clear from day one of pandemic for us that the safety of our people is the number one thing that we are going to focus on. So, you know, we actually limited, you know, in person and you know, being able to go into the office and warehouses to people who really need to be there. But we also implemented all the safety standards to ensure that we are able to, you know, deliver our customers what they need, but doing it you know, safely. I think from a supply chain and from an SLA standpoint, our challenge wasn't necessarily because of, you know, the safety needs or because of social distancing needs. I think we were able to figure that out very quickly because we also, you know, we are OEM, right? So we also manage our own supply chain facilities. For us, it was more about the entire PC industry because the demand for PCs, both for, you know, work needs, you won't believe, but there were so many large companies that only had desktops in the offices. Wow. And they had to get thousands of laptops overnight to, you know, right, make work from home work for their employees. And same with, you know, schools and educational institutes. So for not just for us, but for the entire, you know, PC industry, it really came down to, you know, making sure that we can fulfill our customers' demands and SLAs. And you know, we were fortunate to have, you know, we are fortunate to have such a huge assortment of laptops and desktops and monitors, but we had to make changes from an e-commerce standpoint to meet the SLAs. So when we did not have supply issues, we used to have different kinds of algorithms to show you, you know, what you can buy, what monitors are right for you. But we had to make what you can get tomorrow or what you can get quickly, you know, a first class citizen of our algorithms to make sure that when customers come to the website, we show them a quick ship or fast, you know, fast shipping products first, whether it's monitors or laptops. And so, yes, there were products that had to go on a long lead time. I remember even webcams, you know, being able to get webcams was very, very difficult. And so we made changes from an SLA standpoint to make sure that we show our customers the readily available items on top of our web pages. But I think the teams did a fantastic job at just managing the entire aspect. By the way, we also dealt with a huge tornado in Nashville, where we have our warehouses at the same time as, you know, right before the COVID crisis. So for us, it was, you know, a combination of two different things. But again, it all comes down to, you know, teamwork and making sure that you are prioritizing your needs and keeping the business running.
Yeah, no, I think from everything that you're describing, Harsh, it sounds like a success story all in all. And I think Dell as a firm prepared as well as ready to kind of, you know, take advantage in a good way, in a way that serves the world, you know, of the changes that obviously the pandemic forced. You know, on most of us. So we have a question from Pradeep, which is very interesting to the previous point about kind of going into crypto. But you know, I think you can answer if you want to, but are you offering products and services optimized for Bitcoin farming?
So we don't you know, create custom rigs that we put out there, although we have, you know, debated that in the past, and we have talked about that in the past, but we absolutely do have crypto fans and crypto enthusiasts who build their own rigs using our products, because we have, you know, all kinds of machines and with different levels of GPUs. But so far, we have not ventured into building out rigs for different cryptos ourselves. You know, it's a great idea, and you know, something we have debated sometimes for fun. But no, nothing that we offer today that's built out for a specific crypto.
And what's the outlook on that? What's the internal attitude, Harsh, if I may follow up on that?
We see that as a niche in terms of, you know, the customers who like to build the rigs. I think the reason we probably did not go after that, at least, you know, 5-6 years ago, is because mining Bitcoin, and Bitcoin was the only, you know, prominent crypto back then. And then you started getting all this, you know, new ICOs that started happening, and now you have, you know, cryptos popping up every day. Mining Bitcoin was becoming so much more difficult by day that it did not make sense for us to, you know, create something, you know, for that, because the total available market for those rigs was becoming smaller and smaller. I think the way I'm seeing the crypto market going, the population that, you know, mines it would still remain small from my point of view, while the use cases for DeFi and use cases for blockchain and you know, crypto trading will increase. So we are going to keep an eye on, you know, where the actual mining market goes and whether it expands and make decisions based on data. That's one thing we do really well is we, of course, are very human-centered, design-driven, but we are also very data-driven, and we look at both the things at the same time to decide how big the opportunity is and then go after it.
Right. And I think you have to, right? With the complexity in the world, there used to be a lot of talk, and I know there is some n number of books in the world around leadership, how leaders follow their gut feeling, and everybody's trying to explain that away, right, from everywhere, from like neurological, you know, literature to, you know, success patterns and what have you. But I think we live in such an increasingly interdependent and complex world. You have to rely on data, because there's no way, you know, your sample size is big enough, or your experiences in life are big enough, given how much power corporates have around the world and how they touch people's life. I mean, Facebook has 3 billion users. No country in the world, or no government in the world, touches as many people. And I think, I mean, I've had a bunch of conversations on that, right? And I don't think that reckoning exists within the leadership of corporates. Like, this is a new thing for them. And what that led to over the past 2 quarters in particular for us, we were like, you know, we're talking to all these folks and we don't think they really understand themselves how much power they have and how it's impacting people and everything around the world. And so we just started, you know, curating this working group on decentralized governance, where there is that intent to govern well, but, you know, power is so concentrated, which is the first point of attack anyway, right? Like Zuckerberg has to show up in congressional hearings. So how do you take that? And I know that they have recently instituted something like a Supreme Court of Facebook. Well, it took that long enough. But so how do you kind of, you know, see, you know, e-commerce and sort of companies like Dell, just to kind of broaden the question a little bit here, but from like a more corporate responsibility standpoint, something we're very passionate about here at the Digital Economist. How do you take that, the learning and the recognition of the impact on the world and embed that into, I think, what you're building and what you're taking out of the customers? And I think maybe there could be a two parts sort of response to this question, you know, kind of just drawing from our previous conversation, Harsh, which is one could be, I guess, a more B2C sort of approach. The other is kind of B2B, right? Where I think a lot of the kind of more volume related action is when it comes to business. So curious to hear your thoughts.
Yeah, no, I think when I think about the responsibility, especially as, you know, digital company or digital business, e-commerce business like ours, I think I'll kind of break it down into two parts. One is, especially when it comes to B2C, I think the entire privacy aspect to how we do business is going to become more and more important by the day. And from two different standpoints, one is the awareness around privacy and the awareness around the consequences of, you know, how the data are being used or can be used is at its peak, right? I think people are realizing that more than they ever did before. And you know, that's something we take very, very seriously, both from a standpoint of understanding the laws of different countries, different regions, but also keeping up with where the technology is going based on their philosophies. So if you look at the browsers, you know, that's a great example that I use all the time is, you know, both, you know, Safari as well as Firefox took a stand that, you know, we are basically going to not allow, you know, third-party cookies by default. You know, it really has to be first-party, and even that we are going to put it in the hands of the customers to figure out how to handle them. And that actually becomes much more difficult for companies like Google, who own Chrome, or Microsoft, who owns IE, because their entire business is based on advertisement, which is not what, you know, Firefox does. And so we are seeing a massive shift in, you know, how those companies and browsers that really act as platforms for digital experiences are having to come up with new ways to both balance the needs of the very high awareness now we are seeing with privacy with the needs of their advertisers and advertisement market and advertisement revenue. And, you know, our take is that we need to do the right thing for customers. And we need to do it in the realm of, you know, every region that we support, every country we support, and to make sure that we are staying compliant. But it's also kind of forcing us to think about things differently, right? When we have a lot of, you know, cookies on the website, it does actually slow the experience down. And what we saw that when GDPR came in Europe and the usage of cookies went down, the pages became faster and customer experience became better and customer satisfaction went up. So, you know, you are going to see those things, you know, balance themselves out. On the B2B side, I think it really comes down to ensuring that, you know, whatever we build, whatever we ship to our customers, we are keeping in mind our responsibility in terms of, you know, sustainability, making sure that, you know, we are really looking at our footprint from a standpoint of the kind of material that we use in building our products and ensuring that, you know, we are truly making progress towards building more sustained and sustainable products and services for our customers. So we kind of look at it both from a standpoint of, you know, B2C privacy as well as both B2B and B2C environmental sustainability.
Right. So Harsh, I know you previously mentioned about how businesses are shifting, right? So Dell works with 90% of the Fortune 500 companies. And obviously this includes traditional industries as well, right? Oil and gas and dinosaur industries, let's just call them that. And, you know, we were talking about, of course, how, you know, digital companies are obviously doing very well with, you know, a world that's under lockdowns. But how are you then dealing with, you know, your counterparties that are businesses in turn, whether it's from a partnership perspective or from a client perspective? But there is a much steeper learning curve, if you may, or I think a much longer journey, digital transformation journey, right? And how's that sort of playing out in your role and what you're seeing at Dell kind of at the leadership level?
Yeah, no, that's very true. That is, I think it's not lost on any company in the world, regardless of the industry, as to the fact that you have to transform digitally, and not just transform digitally from a technology standpoint, but also from a process and people standpoint and from a culture standpoint. And like you say, we do see different level of maturity as to the point at which each company or each sector is from a transformation standpoint. But the one common theme that we are seeing is that everyone is wanting to and willing to digitally transform. Just that they are at a different point in the journey. And so what it means for us is that we have to make sure that we understand each sector and adapt the needs. For example, we actually drive a pretty large chunk of our business from an e-commerce standpoint via what we call a B2B integrations, where if you are a large company, you might be using Ariba or Coupa or SAPs of the world within your environment, and you are really letting your team members and employees use those systems to do business with Dell, right? To buy systems and buy laptops and desktops and servers, et cetera. But then we are also seeing, companies that have digitally transformed who are using more, rich, feature-rich, web-based SaaS experiences like ServiceNow or Zendesks or Zoho's of the world, where they actually need a lot more modern APIs. The great thing is that we are seeing everyone, both the ERP systems and ITSM systems moving towards the modern APIs, where they can build really rich experiences for, B2B customers. And B2B customers themselves are now expecting a lot more consumer-like experience as opposed to, I'm just a procurement person and I don't care about experience. No, I care about the B2B experience to be as, smooth as consumer. And so, what we are having to do is, we are having to make sure that we keep the lights on companies and clients that are still transforming. They are early in their journey and give them, the legacy mechanisms to interact with us. But at the same time, not only keep up with, but accelerate giving the companies that have transformed already or startups who are, starting digital first, because that's the other difference that you see is that there are large companies that have all the resources, but they have so much legacy that even if they want to transform, it takes them time. But there are companies that started in, 2010s, and they already started digital first, and they are able to move faster. And so for us, it's the balancing act, right? And it's true for any, tech service provider that you have to balance between, your largest customers who are transforming slowly to your, most, digitally savvy customers who are moving faster. It's the same for us. We will have to continue, performing this balancing act until everyone has transformed. And by then, I'm hoping that there is another wave of, transformation, and probably everything is happening via AR, VR, and AI and ML, and we go through that cycle again.
Right. That's how we make money, right? So yeah, no, that definitely sounds like an opportunity, and I think you've perfectly captured how business happens. So if anyone, I don't think this audience here we have today live needs a reminder, but I think that kind of captures it beautifully. So I have a question for you, Harsh, that I just popped into my head as you were talking. What kind of computer do you have right now that you're joining from?
I have a Latitude that I'm using right now. It's a 2-in-1, our 7000 series, but I'm also getting, our latest, 9000 series Latitude, which is fantastic. It comes with, a safe, camera shutter that automatically identifies, when you are in a meeting, and it turns it on, it turns it off. So you don't have to worry about, people put the stickers on their laptop cameras. You don't have to do that anymore. It has, fantastic fingerprint-based security and LTE connection. So I'm looking forward to getting the next laptop. But I also use, for my personal use, I have an XPS 13, which is our most lightweight and travel-friendly machine that that we are really proud of. So those are the machines I use. I do have in my bucket list getting an Alienware. So not a lot of people, you know, realize that, but we do own Alienware as well, which we acquired probably 10 to 15 years ago. And they make fantastic gaming machines. So I do want to get one of those Alienware machines sometime.
Oh, that's right. You're one of those. The gamers here.
Right. I'm a console gamer. That's why I don't have an Alienware, but I do want to get it just because it looks so cool.
Yeah. No, that's interesting. So I think my question was kind of, so you are a Dell loyalist. A lot of time I've seen. I was hoping everything. You'll say Apple, and I was like, aha, gotcha. Oh,
nope.
No, that's great. That's good. And you know, talking about gaming, actually, and we were kind of, we had this panel, Harsh, earlier today, and it was on whether meaningful work is the ultimate goal of life. So kind of a philosophical reckoning around, are we on the planet to work? And I want to tie that to the gaming industry and automation in general, which is that as more and more sort of machines take over our work, this need for less and less humans. And as an economist, I can confirm that when we look at like labor movements around the world and wages, which have been stagnant over the past 20 years. So you have a segment of the population that's creating platforms, right? And they are in an exceptional position to acquire sort of the value that platform, anyone who interacts with the platform creates, concentrate sort of that and exploit that, if you may, as we technically say in economics. I promise it's not a negative term in econ. And on the other hand, so there's the rest of the consumers, right? And we continue to see that if you sort of correct for inflation, wages are actually stagnant. And they have been around that even well before the 2007 and 8 crisis. Now, how is that sort of tying into digital transformation and gaming? Is that the hypothesis, the common hypothesis is as work is changing and we probably would need less and less people to work on jobs that existed previously, right? So you seek sort of the Uberization of the economy, if you may. And one of the reasons why we're seeing so much interest and expansion, I think gaming is around $3 billion industry right now around the world, is because, you know, people don't have sort of, you know, a lot of traditional sort of work. And it's only going to expand, right, as more automation reduces the need for humans. Because really, I mean, you got to take a step back and think to yourself, are 8 billion people going to have meaningful work in 2050, right? It's a depressing thing to think about, but what are your thoughts on this? I'm so interested because I know you're a gamer yourself, so.
Yeah, I was smiling because, you know, I have been part of this debate as to what automation means for people and for population that's in different kind of labor that's getting automated. While, you know, we will have to see over the long period of time as to what it does to the world and to the economy and to people's livelihoods. From everything I'm seeing from my vantage point, I truly believe that it is going to create more opportunities. And this is why I say that. And I'll use some very specific examples, right? Generally the arguments that, you know, we make and I also make is that, hey, the work itself is not going away. Someone has to automate it. And yes, people have to, you know, reskill themselves. And when you talk about reskilling, the argument you get from the opposite side is that, hey, you know, it's not easy for someone to have worked in certain industry doing manual work to be in their, you know, late in their career and start learning how to do AI ML or how to do development and how to learn how to code or how to learn how to automate. I think even the software jobs, even writing software is going to be automated in the future. So I'll give a simple example. you know, I hadn't coded for a long time. You know, I was a software engineer, you know, 13 years ago. But now there are tools out there, no code tools that allow me to build prototypes, but I can actually build things out. So if you think about, let's say, you know, manufacturing job, when someone is automating manufacturing jobs, the actual domain knowledge of what goes into manufacturing is with people who are manufacturing. And I really think that in the future world, there would be tools out there that would allow, you know, people who used to do manual manufacturing to help code without actually having to write, you know, complex code, actually, you know, build logic around how to drive automation of manufacturing, or how to drive automation of building games, or how to drive automation of, you know, writing platforms. And so I'm an optimist. I really think that, you know, that's where the world is going. Is it going to require people to, you know, change the way they think about it, you know, keep an open mind, you know, continuously learn? I think that's going to be required. And that's also required for, you know, people like you and me. You know, I'm having to change by day. I actually do reverse mentorship from Gen Zs in my company. I actually sit down with interns and I learn from them that, you know, they want to shop differently. And then we take those learnings and, you know, make changes on our e-commerce website. So I think whether it's, you know, it's the manual work that you are doing that's getting automated, or you are a CTO, or you are a CEO or CIO, everyone will have to continuously learn and reskill themselves. And in the past, you know, that cycle used to take 10 years, 15 years. Now it's going to take much shorter amount of time, and people will have to reskill them, you know, much more quickly. So like I said, I'm an optimist. I think it's only going to create more opportunities for people. But like you said, you know, we'll have to let it play it out and see where it actually goes.
So I think there is an interesting dynamic that we're probably going to be seeing, which is folks like yourself who see the potential as to where, you know, a lot of this is going to create jobs more immediately. And we're going to have a lot more tech literate population, not just from a consumption perspective, but from a sort of a builder perspective. And so I'm guessing design is going to become even bigger from what you just said. And that's perhaps, you know, considering the next 10, 20, or perhaps even a little bit more years in the future. So I think the timelines we're looking at become sort of a key factor as to, okay, how much into the future are we extrapolating this into? But, you know, on the other hand, the governments, and Harsh, it's so interesting because we saw these dynamics play out. I cannot help but keep quoting from the summit, because we brought in policy, you know, workforce agencies and mayors and such, and the future work, where there are all these protections and money that the US government gives out constantly. And there's a lot of money for, you know, workforce development and upskilling of your skills or what have you on one hand. And, you know, so there's a lot of this protection mechanism that could almost be adversely used, or can sort of have some sort of what we call, disincentives. And on the other hand, you know, for folks who are eager to learn and sort of, you know, lifelong learners by nature are naturally going to sort of thrive in the next, you know, couple of decades or so. And I think it's kind of really hard to think about humanity and work sort of beyond that in many ways, and sort of, you know, will the governments continue to shelter and sort of preserve old school work, you know, and pump money in the system when, I mean, a lot of the times from a productivity standpoint, a lot of the jobs actually don't create any productivity gains, right? From a more technical perspective, but they do exist. And so will we see entire populations having to reskill, or are humans too lazy to do that? So I think that's an open-ended question. It sounds like we're almost getting started on this conversation, and I know we've been an hour in. So we definitely have to continue this, Harsh. So fascinating. And I think you're in a role where, like you said, you're learning and you're implementing at the same time. And, you know, and that's, it's really kind of, you know, what all of us are kind of together in as kind of a shared humanity. But any last message that you would like to leave us with? We got 2 minutes left in the conversation. And of course, a fantastic audience of peers have joined us today.
Well, look, I loved the conversation. I think, like you said, we can spend another hour talking about where the world would go with automation and what it would need for reskilling. I think, really the parting thoughts that I have is that the world is going to continue transforming, and the transformation would move at different pace across geographies. And what is important for all of us, whether you're in tech, whether in non-tech, whether you're in design role, product role, policy role, is to make sure that we are truly working backwards from the humans, the people, whether they are your customers, whether they are your users, or they are the people you are serving. We start from there and work backwards in figuring out what exactly we are trying to solve. At times, we end up arguing over our own philosophies, our own confidence. And I was just reading Adam Grant's Think Again last week, and he talked about, in the book, he talked about, being confident versus being, having imposter syndrome. And he said the best way you can make right judgments and right calls and right decisions is by having confident humility. So I would say that, everyone should develop confident humility. And that's what's going to help us make this world a much better place as we move forward.
Agreed. And beautiful message, and completely resonate, Harsh. Like, we set out Digital Economist last year, and continue to build with the mission of driving technological convergence towards a human-centered digital economy. I think over the past 1 hour, and with your final parting message to the audience, you've basically brought us home to exactly that. So thank you very much for joining us today. It's been fantastic, and we definitely have to continue this conversation. I'm seeing some amazing commentary and encouragement from the audience here as well. And again, thank you very much for joining us today. We're delighted to have you. And once again, my name is Navroop Sahdev, and you were talking to The Digital Economist. We'll see you next week. Thanks all.